The array has been around for a very long time, but very few people really know how it works. In this video, we'll be diving into the mechanics of this really important data structure. We'll be talking about what happens when you add data, remove data, or retrieve data from an array. We're also going to examine the strengths and limitations of an array so that you understand when it would be best to use an array and when you might want to consider using something else. Before I start this lesson, I kindly ask you to consider subscribing to this channel and turning on notifications. Your support means a lot to me and it helps me create more informative and valuable videos. In any case, let's start with Chapter 1, the Array Mechanics. We can start with a very broad definition. An array is a collection of closely related values. Here we have an array that stores a sequence of numbers from 1 to 5. If I want to create this array in Python, it's literally as simple as typing it out. If I want to remove an element, once again, I can just say remove, and magically a number gets removed. So as you can see, the code is incredibly simple, but behind the scenes, there are so many moving parts that we fail to acknowledge what's really going on. To understand the underlying mechanics of an array, we need to go back to the 1940s when computers were just invented. Back then, if you wanted to code something, you wouldn't have had the luxury of a high-level programming language like Python or Java. You would have had to use a language called assembly to communicate directly with the hardware components of a computer. And in assembly language, there is no such thing as, hey, make me an array with 5 numbers inside. You would have had to specify every little detail of how data was going to be stored and managed in memory. Think about memory as a sequence of storage containers, where each container is called a byte. A byte can hold up to 8 bits of data, with each bit representing a binary number, either 0 or 1. Each byte is stored at a unique location, a unique memory address, similar to how your home address identifies where you live. This piece of data lives at the memory address 100B. It follows that when programming in assembly and there's a particular value that you want to store, say 56, you have to specify the location in memory where you want to store it. You can't just let it wander around aimlessly. So this piece of code stores the number 56 at the memory location 100D. But before doing so, you gotta turn your number into binary. That means repeatedly dividing it by 2 until you can no longer do so, and recording all of the remainders. However, for large integers such as 700, the division process generates 10 remainders, which cannot fit in an 8-bit byte. So instead of writing a single byte of data into memory, you can modify the instruction to reserve a quote-unquote double word. 4 bytes in memory from the starting address. 4 bytes can hold 32 bits, which is plenty for the binary version of 700. Beautiful. Now we need to make some adjustments so that we can scale this explanation to cover arrays. Instead of showing the actual assembly code, I will start describing what happens at the assembly level. And instead of representing integer values in binary, I'm just going to keep them in a human-friendly format to save space. Cool. With that out of the way, we can dive into the main topic of this video, arrays. Given the following collection of values, how does it actually store in memory? At the assembly level, the first step is to reserve a contiguous block of memory large enough to store the values. The term contiguous means that the memory locations are physically connected without any gaps or interruptions. So the operating system will start at a specific address, let's say 1000, and for each integer in the collection, the program reserves 4 bytes of storage within the block. The second step is to calculate the memory address of each element. The program does that by repeatedly adding 4 bytes from the base address, so 1000, 1004, etc. And now the obvious step is to store the values in memory. The program writes the value of each element to its corresponding memory address. Beautiful, that is all for storage. Now we can cover the mechanics of retrieving data from an array. In high-level languages like Python or Java, each element is assigned a unique index that starts from 0. Accessing the element at index 2 magically returns 580. But it's not quite as simple as that. Behind the scenes, the index is multiplied by the size of each element. Each element takes up 4 bytes in memory. 2 multiplied by 4 bytes is equal to 8. And then the result is added to the base address of the array. 1000 plus 8 is 1008. And so from the starting address, we can move over to the calculated memory location and get the value stored over there. So now we can expand on our previous definition and say that elements of an array are stored in a contiguous block of memory, and each element has a unique memory address within that block. Okay, going back, what actually happens when we add an element to an array? In high-level languages like Python or Java, you can simply say insert the element at index 2, and it magically inserts the element right in the middle. Now, despite the perception that inserting an element is a simple problem, behind the scenes, it's actually very tedious. The problem with arrays is that their size is fixed. This array has a fixed size of 12 bytes, and if I want to make room for another element, I have to reserve a new block of memory with a size of 16 bytes. And then one by one, elements from the old block of memory are copied over to the new block of memory, while making room for the element that we want to insert. We had to do all of that work just to make room for a single value. Can you imagine how slow this process would be if there were a million elements to copy over, or 10 million elements to copy over? That's when you'll start noticing a very big difference. Okay, now what actually happens when you remove an element from an array? Again, in a high-level language like Python, you can just say remove this element at index 2, and it magically removes the element at that index. But do not be fooled. The actual process is very expensive. Because the size is fixed at 16 bytes, the process demands a new block of memory that fits the smaller collection. And then one by one, elements from the old block of memory are added to the new one, disregarding the element that you don't want to include. We had to do all of that work only to remove a single value. That's pretty bad. Cool, now that you understand the mechanics of an array, we can identify where arrays are very strong and where they are very weak. Going back to the present, the most commonly presented model for an array is one where a collection of elements are placed side by side, each one with a unique index. This is a simple representation of what arrays actually are, but if we keep in mind the underlying mechanics that we just talked about, we can still illustrate the primary weakness of an array: inserting or removing data. If I want to insert an element into the array, instead of going all the way to the memory level, I can just say that generally, a new array with a different size needs to be created, and old elements are copied over before inserting the new value. We can also use this model to illustrate the primary strength of an array, retrieving data, because no matter how big the array is, accessing an element based on its index is a very quick operation because we saw that at the lowest level of memory, calculating the memory address based on an index is really fast. Okay, enough theory, let's see all of this in action. So here in Python, I have an array with about 1,500,000 elements, and I want to access the element at index 750,000. Now, regardless of the size of the array, accessing an element based on an index will be exceptionally fast. But the weakness of an array is highlighted when we try to perform an operation that involves changing its size, like inserting an element right in the middle. That should take a pretty long time. It should take about 5 or 6 seconds, which in the world of programming is astronomical. And removing an element from the middle should take a long time as well. Notice that the runtime is still going. Give it a few more seconds. And now it's finally done. That's pretty crazy. But once again, I'm not surprised because I understand the underlying mechanics. I know exactly why these operations took so long and that the array data structure is very weak when it comes to operations that involve changing its size. But that's when you would want to use a linked list, and we'll be looking at that data structure in the next video. I hope to see you there. But in the meantime, if you enjoyed this video, please feel free to subscribe to the channel if you would like to see more content like this.